Next, let's go to volume. Something to know about volume is that when we're discussing systems of any human scale, a meter, especially a meter cubed, is very, very big. It's way too big a unit for any sort of tabletop or lab experiment. So we very typically will be using smaller units for our volumes. For example, we might be using a cubic centimeter, where a centimeter, of course, is 1/100th of a meter. So a cubic centimeter is much smaller. Or for a slightly larger unit, we could maybe use 1,000 cubic centimeters, and that is called 1 liter. And when you're looking at this, be careful not to be confused by what we have here. You might be tempted to think initially that 1,000 cubic centimeters might be a cubic meter, or maybe 10 cubic meters. But remember that we're talking about cubed units, not linear units, which means that 1 meter cubed is in fact 1,000,000 cubic centimeters, which you can see from our picture. In fact, a cubic meter is many, many more cubic centimeters than a liter is. Now let's discuss temperature. What we're going to do is first think about what temperature is. Where does temperature arise from? If we sort of zoomed in, what we could do is take a look at a picture like the one we have on the right here, and imagine all these particles moving around and bouncing off of each other and off the walls of whatever container that they're in. So what we do to define a new unit of temperature is define what's called a Kelvin scale for temperature. And this is very simply to say that we define 0 kelvins, or our zero of temperature, to be the point at which all the particles, as we have written on the bottom here, have stopped moving. They're not moving anywhere anymore. And so we define this point to be our zero of temperature. This absolute scale, the absolute zero, occurs at minus 273.15 degrees Celsius, which means that to define our Kelvin scale, we need to shift our system. We need to shift it so that this point is what we call zero. To do this, what we would do is literally to shift it by this exact number. So we say that the temperature in kelvins will be the temperature in Celsius plus this number 273.15. Also, very importantly, since all we've done is shifted our Celsius scale, we haven't multiplied it by any scaling numbers or anything like that, the size of what we would call a Kelvin is the same size as a degree Celsius. And for example, this would not be the case for a comparison, for example, between Celsius and Fahrenheit. A degree Fahrenheit and a degree Celsius are actually different in size, whereas a degree Kelvin, which we actually simply call a Kelvin rather than a degree Kelvin, is the same size as a degree in Celsius. And we'll be using this fact later on. Lastly, our last way of measuring things is to ask how much of this thing is there, or how many molecules of this gas do we have. What we do to define the number of molecules is, as you might expect, there are many, many molecules in 1 gram of a substance. If I looked at a gram in my hand, there'd be some powder or something, and there are many, many, many atoms or many molecules of substance in something that is big enough that we could actually see it. So instead of just counting the number and using this very, very large number, what we do is we define a new unit called a mole. And we define a mole as the number of carbon-12 atoms to make up 12 grams of actual macroscopic visible substance. The number I've been referring to, this very huge number that it takes to make up anything that's big enough to be seen, is 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd objects. So this unit of mole is just measuring a number. It's just a number of objects. It doesn't have any physical units like meters or anything like that. It's just a number. So I could say, for example, a mole of apples or a mole of planets and just be measuring a huge number of any object. To get a sense for how big this number is, it's actually more than the number of grains of sand that exist on the Earth, which means that if you have 1 gram of substance in your hand and you're looking at it, the number of particles in there, if it's one mole, will be this astronomically humongous number. And so keep in mind the sense of exactly the scale of things, because again, a mole is quite big. So that you're able to use this very practically, something that you will need to know, is that the way the periodic table is often written is to give the element name. For example, we have carbon and nitrogen and oxygen listed here. And then below the element name to list how many grams of that atom would be in 1 mole of that atom. For example, we have here carbon. If I took 1 mole of carbon, just scooped it up from the Earth somewhere, the number of grams in that mole of carbon would be 12.01. And just be careful here, it might seem confusing. We said that we defined a mole based on carbon. So why isn't there exactly 12 grams in one mole of carbon? And the reason for this is simply that if I did scoop up some carbon just from around me in what we would call natural abundance, just from the Earth, some of that carbon would not be carbon-12. It would be an isotope, carbon-13, which is slightly heavier. And so we defined moles based on carbon-12, this particular atom, so that the actual carbon in its natural abundance would be slightly heavier if we took an entire mole of that carbon.